As you, Father God, have been here with us, Father God, we ask that you continue, Father God, to move us in the right direction, God, to give us, Father God, that anointing, Father God, that we so longly desperate for, God. And I praise you, Father God. I thank you, Lord God, for what you're doing in Living Word Family, Lord God, what you're about to do, God, and what you have done, Lord God. We come here to worship you, God. We give you this day, this night, Father God, all the honor and all the glory belongs to you. In Jesus' mighty name, Living Word of Upland says, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Give it up for Jesus one more time. Amen. Hallelujah. I feel the Holy Ghost fire. Hallelujah. And that's the only thing that keeps us alive. Amen. Let's go ahead and grab your seat right now. We're going to get ready for the announcements. Amen. Okay, sorry about that, church. How's everybody doing tonight? Amen. So we're going to go ahead and do this Holy Ghost style. Amen. So on February the 25th, Men of Action. Amen. How many men we got in the house? Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go ahead and get ready. Wives, mothers, send your husbands, your sons out to go get fed by the word. Amen. Because we need the word no matter what day it is. Men of Action, there's always something exciting going on with Living Word, amen. And it's going to be at our mother church in Chino Hills. Everything is free. There's no cover charge. Just show up and be ready to get fed with the Word of God. We're going to have free tacos, amen. How many like free tacos, amen? Nobody has to score a touchdown. Nobody has to score a home run for this one, amen. This is all free, and it's all covered by our mother church out of Chino Hills, amen. And the next announcement will be, remember our Sunday morning service. Invite somebody. Tomorrow when you go to work, just say, hey, I know where they're having a little get-together, and just bring them out to church. Amen. We have to do the inviting everywhere we go. If you go to Walmart, you go to the local, wherever, the Panderia, wherever you're at, invite somebody to church. Amen. Let them know that something good is happening right here in Living Word of Upland. You know, if you have to lure them in by buying them a piece of bond, whatever, bring them here. Amen. Tell them there's something going on. It's exciting. It's exciting to be here in the house of God, because God is on the move. Amen. God is always up to something. God is always doing something behind the scenes. Amen.
Amen.
Let's give it up for Jesus one more time. And everybody knows what time it is. It's time to give back to the Lord and pass it over to Brother Anthony. Amen.
All right, church. Welcome, Radicals. How you guys doing?
Amen.
All right. So before we get started, let's call our ushers up. All right. So today, church, like always, we have three ways to give. We have through our Zelle app, our Living Word of Upland checks, and through our tithing envelopes. And if anybody needs an envelope, just a show of hands. Alright, church, everybody be blessed.
Amen.
Amen? Come on, church, let's get excited today.
Amen.
Alright, now how many of us know obedience goes a long way?
Amen.
Especially in this walk with the Lord.
Amen.
You know that obedience brings favor.
Yes.
How many needs favor?
Amen.
Why? Now, the scripture I got for us today is off of John chapter 14:23, off the Message, and it says right here, because a loveless world, said Jesus, is a sightless world. If anyone loves me, he will carefully keep my word, and my Father will love him. We'll move right into the neighborhood. Not loving me means not keeping my words. Amen? Now, church, I don't know nothing. But one thing I do know is God's word will never fail us.
Amen.
We have to remember that he knows what's best for our lives, and whatever he says goes. So when he says to give, it's because it's the right thing to do, right?
Amen.
We don't serve a greedy God. We serve a righteous God.
Amen.
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 Now, in the scripture, it says, if you love me, then follow my words. Mm. How many of us love to hear, I love you?
Yes.
Like, it's good to hear that, right?
Yes.
But how many of us know it's even better to act on it, right?
Amen.
To feel the action of that real love.
Amen.
See, today, church, let's show our God that we love him by acting on his word. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah.
All right. if you guys could join me, rise, join on, pray over the tithes and offerings. Heavenly Father, my God, we thank you. Yes, Heavenly Father, my Lord, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for bringing us all into your house in this gathering, my Lord, to feel your presence, my Lord. My Lord, we ask that you let the Holy Spirit lead us today, my God. Lead us and open our minds, open our ears, open our eyes to what's really going on, my God. My Lord, we pray for something spiritual, my God, not material, my God. My Lord, you could take all the blessings, my God, because all we need is you. You are the true blessing that we need, my God. We want more of you, my God. My Lord, we ask that you do something mighty today, my God. If anything is going on in our lives, my God, we ask that you pause it, my God. Let us know that everything is okay with you in our lives, my God. We love you. We thank you for what you do, my God. In Jesus' my name we pray. Amen.
Amen. We're gonna go ahead and dismiss the ushers, but let's give it up for the Lord tonight.
Amen.
Come on, let's give it up for the Lord tonight. Amen. You know what better place but to be in the house of God? That's the way I see it. You know that shows our true dedication to the Lord. Amen. And we're here tonight, and that's very, very, you know, good. That, you know, we put God first, amen? And how many of us know that that's very, very important to God? Because that's his people, amen? And like I said, you know, we're on a course. And, you know, we got to believe that we're on this course. And it's a course that we have to understand that God is good. But right now, before we get started with our service, we're going to go ahead and dismiss our children because they're all looking at me like, Pastor, let me go to class. I don't want to miss out, amen? But it's good, amen. Thank God for our teachers, amen. Come on, we're going to talk for Jesus this time. I'm going to read off of Colossians, amen. And we were talking about it, you know, last Wednesday. And I'm going to continue on Wednesday because I believe that we need to kind of get a little bit more of the breakdown of that word that we're reading in Colossians. But in Colossians chapter 3, and, you know, we're going to go ahead and sit down, amen, because I'm going to read almost the whole chapter on it. Because I really believe that we have to understand that there's two courses that are set in our lives. And I believe that many of us are not understanding it yet. You know, that, you know, if we're a child of God or claim to be a child of God, we have to understand that we have to be on the course of being a child of God. Many of us are still not understanding that, but right here, Paul is writing to the colossal church, amen. And he's writing in the scripture to the Colossians, trying to explain to them, because how many of us know that sometimes we get drifted away, amen? Or is it just the pastor? I hope not, amen. We get drifted away of what? Of the truth. The truth, you know, the Bible says it will set you free. But many of us are on course. We'll start coming to the course, amen. We talked about what is a course. A course is it's to get us from point to point. And that's what God's intentions are. It's basically to build our faith.
Amen.
But we have to get from point to point. It doesn't mean because you come in that course that you're just going to stay right there in putt one. We have to understand. So we talked about, you know, we've been talking about all week, then in this course, we're going to learn how to set goals in our life. Our main goal should be Jesus Christ, amen? Amen. That's our main goal that we should be shooting for. Amen. But still, throughout these, you know, areas, we have to get a whole 18, amen?
Yes.
So we got to start putting in putt one. So last week, or this Saturday, Sunday, I was talking about we need tools. How many of us know that we need tools, amen?
We need tools.
It's like going to the golf course without a golf club. What are you going to do? Just stand there? Watch the other people's going a putt too? In reality, that's what happens. And then we start complaining. Why am I still here?
because you haven't even got a golf club, amen. But not only that, we need golf shoes as well, amen, right? And also we need to learn that we need to have God's uniform. Could I get an amen?
Amen.
Right here, Paul explains, in this course, there's two courses of life. One of them is the course of the world, which the Bible clearly states that it's broad and many people are on it. But it's also, he's explaining here, as chosen children. Do you believe that you're chosen tonight?
Yes, amen.
How many of you truly believe that you've been chosen and called?
Yep.
Amen. I'm at the right church. I was getting ready to minister to the one down the street. But now that we're here, let's go to Colossians chapter 3. And I'm going to read it all the way to 17. Like I said, we need to kind of go back. I started on 12 to 17, but I think we need to hear the other course. Okay? Colossians chapter 3. It goes like this in verse 1. Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on the things above. This evening, where is your heart at? Is it in the things above? Which is Jesus Christ. Amen. It says, since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on the things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Amen.
Amen.
Then it goes on, set your minds, not only your hearts, but what else? Your minds. It said, on the things above, not on earthly things, amen? Everybody say, no, shucks, Pastor, why do you have to say that? Amen? But it goes, set your minds on the things above, not on the earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ. In God, when Christ, who is your life, amen? Is Christ your life this evening?
Amen.
I sure hope so, amen? I know he's my life.
Amen.
Who is your life appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Amen?
Amen.
That means when we die from this part right now, we're going to appear with him in glory.
Amen.
Because we're not the old person that we used to be.
Thank you, Jesus.
And then it tells right here why. Put to death. Tell your neighbor, put to death. And your other one too, so they don't be left out. Whatever belongs to the earthly nature. Amen?
Amen.
Sexual immoralities, impurities, lust, evil desires, and greed. This is the course, the other course. Amen? This is the course that we shouldn't be on no more. But then it goes on, which is adultery. Because of this, the wrath of God is coming. You used to, tell your neighbor, I used to. Walk in these ways. But in the life you once lived. But now you must also rid yourself of all such things as these. And this is where it gets good. Because I know this church don't have that. As you once did such of these things. Okay? Anger. Nobody here gets angry, right? Right? All right. Or we get hangry. You get hangry when you're hungry? Hangry, amen. Should have put that one on there too. Rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practice. Amen. These are all the practices of the old self. And have put on the new self. Amen. Which is being renewed in the knowledge, in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentiles or Jews, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, amen, Scythian, amen, slave or free, but Christ is all, and is in all, amen?
Amen.
And here we go, this is where we're at now. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, amen, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one's body, you are called to peace. And be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. In whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, I just thank you, Lord, tonight, Father God, for the opportunity, Father God, to come out here today, Lord, and be able, Father God, to minister this word, Lord. Let us open up our hearts. Let us open up our minds, Father God. Let us remove, Father God, anything that is keeping us from your word tonight, Lord. And let it impact our hearts, Father God, so we can obtain the word in our hearts, Lord. But through it all, Lord Jesus, tonight, we want to continue to give you the praise, the honor, and the mighty glory. In Jesus' name, the church says, amen, amen and amen. And let's give it up for Jesus tonight. Oh, come on, let's give it up for him. Amen. So basically, what it's talking about, Paul's talking about, is that we need to learn to put on our spiritual clothes. Amen? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just like we get up in the morning and change and get dressed. I hope we do. Amen? Amen. We have to also learn to put on our spiritual clothes. Because how many of us know when we talked about that if we're going to stay on course, there's going to be a war, there's going to be a battle. But if you're not putting on your suit, you're going to miss it all. Just look at your neighbor real slow. They say, man, they're out of control. But don't say nothing, amen. Look at your other neighbor too real slow. See, Jesus, amen. Thank you, they're in here today. But we have to understand, as we wake up in the morning, we should be clothing ourselves with the spiritual clothes, amen. And I'm not just talking in breakfast, amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for this amen muffin and this coffee. Amen. No, Jesus wants us to get into a fervent prayer. To get into that presence, amen. Because how many of us know that we need to tap in? Because the day is going to be long. Amen. And you're probably going to be not having compassion. And we're going to get to it, amen. Because I want to kind of touch on it so we can understand. But just as every morning we put on our clothes, we need to know how to put on our spiritual clothes as well. Amen. Amen. Ephesians 6:10 through 18 will tell you how to put on your armor, amen. See, armor of God, and you can read it later, but this is something that we need to learn to do daily. This is not just one day. Well, I put on the armor today, but you go into battle tomorrow when you don't put it on. Here we go again. Let's get back. As God's chosen people, we need to clothe ourselves with godly clothing. With who? Godly. We need to put on Jesus, amen? Amen. That means smile. Huh? I had a bad day today. I'm going to smile, amen? Sometimes we forget that we are chosen by God. And I believe this is where we miss it. We're on course, right? We're in the game now. Maybe we might put the ball a couple of times. But sometimes we forget that we've been chosen by God to play on his team. Amen? Amen. Remember this. God chooses people, and there is a clothing line that he wants us to put on. This is when we're talking. We're going to get to it. People are recognized how they dress or what they wear. As you see the men's home, they all sometimes come looking like cholos. Amen?
Amen.
And then later on, we do a transformation. Amen. That was a joke, okay, guys? Some of you will catch it later. But sometimes we forget that we are chosen by God. Amen. You see, the enemy also has a clothing line. And this evening, whose clothing line are you wearing? Let it simmer a little bit. So now we're understanding the enemy has a clothing line as well. And he wants to dress you up tonight. You see, he wants you to wear his clothing as well. But you see, as God's chosen, we should be recognized on how we dress. If you say you're a child of God, are people recognizing you are a Christian tonight? Or do we go back to the same thing as we were with the earthly things just to try to fit in? Well, let it marinate, amen. God's chosen our clothes. What is our clothes? We talked about it. Compassion, kindness, humility, gentle, and patience. I'm going to break them down a little bit for you guys, okay? These are the things we need to clothe ourselves if we're one of God's chosen people. Amen?
Amen.
This is what God wants us to wear. We talked about it on Wednesday. Anthony did. He talked about compassion. What is compassion? I'm glad you all raised your hands at one time. Amen? But let me tell you what compassion is. Compassion is being an assistant. It's having care for others. And it's understanding. Is that what we carry tonight? You see, we talked about compassion. There has to be compassion in our hearts if we're willing to clothe ourselves as God's chosen people. We have to know that the devil's clothing line as well. What is the opposite of compassion? It's being insensitive. Has anybody ever walked in, you know, I'm saved, hallelujah, forget everybody else? I don't have no more compassion towards people. I don't know, that shouldn't be, that's not really having the clothesline of God. You have to be compassionate. The Bible says that we should be the light of the world, amen? That way the light can shine through us. Because how many of us know that we have family members that are still lost in this world? And God wants to use you. Tell your neighbor, you. He wants to clothe you tonight.
Amen.
With these things. These are his virtues. The virtues are love, hope, and being faithful. Amen. But these are the virtues of God. But he wants you to carry his clothing line as happy Christians. Amen. Tell your neighbor, you're still going to go through things. But now you're going to learn to deal with them through God. Because we talked about Paul. Paul says, I press on towards the goal.
Amen.
That I've been called heavenward.
Amen.
Meaning that there's going to be opposition. Amen. If there's no opposition in your life. Amen. Then you must be doing something wrong. You got to go through things in life so your faith can mature.
Amen.
It's like a baby drinking a titi. Amen? 5 years old. The Bible says that we need to grow and mature from the milk teachings, amen, to getting solid food.
Amen.
And many of us still want to stay an infant. I'm going to tell you. The truth, you got to grow.
Amen.
Once you see a baby 5 years, I'm still going to church, but I'm still the same way. And I still want milk. And I still don't want to be used. So you're still on TP. Amen? You got to grow. Remember I told you, faith is not what you believe. Because we can all say, oh, I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he saved me. But faith is what you're going to endure through. That's when real faith comes in. You better call it when it's going all good and dandy. Accept that season in your life. But when the water hits a manteca and it's all popping, you better learn to trust him still. And this is where your faith is going to grow.
Amen.
And he's going to show you. You see, son, I got you.
That's right.
Not you. Yeah. Amen. Amen. I also remember the devil is always trying to take us off the course. And I see it all the time. Men and women of God, good, strong men and women of God. They come into the house of God, really wanting to do the things of God, but something happens. They end up getting discouraged. They end up letting the values of this earth take them away. Remember, God has a plan for you.
Amen.
And you have to understand this. Amen?
Amen.
In Ephesians 4:32, or let me go to Mark 6:34 first. It says, when Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because there were sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. Amen. In Ephesians 4:32 says, be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgive each other just as Christ God forgave you. Always share this with everybody. You know, someone says, Pastor, you don't even know what this person did to me. If you knew what they did to me, then tell me, would you forgive them? Well, understand this. Forgiveness is not for them. Forgiveness is for you. Because the Bible says, if you judge, you will be judged as well. So in other words, God says, forgive those who trespass against you as you've been forgiven of your own sins.
Amen. Amen.
And that's why we forgive. Some of us are going to have harder things than others to forgive others. But always remember, forgiveness is really for you. So that way you'll be right in God's eyes. God says, let the vengeance be mine. Lord, here they are. It's yours.
Yes.
Handle it. Amen. Whatever I'm going through, amen, whatever this person did to me, I forgive them for the way they did. Whatever they did to me, I forgive them. But the vengeance is yours, Lord. I give it to you. And I forgive them.
Amen.
And then I wait. Hopefully they get diarrhea. Like this. No, I'm just waiting. But still, understanding. Be kind and compassionate to one another. Forgive each other, just as Christ forgave you. Who is one that demonstrates compassion? It's Jesus Christ. He had compassion for the people. He has compassion for us. Because without Jesus, we would not be able to have life with the Father. It was only through what Jesus Christ did on that cross. Amen? And also, compassion goes beyond words. Amen? It's not saying I'm a compassionate person, amen? When in reality, you look like you bit a lemon. Amen? Also, the Bible says in Colossians to have kindness. In other words, kindness is a choice. We have to want to be kind. Tell your neighbor, you got to want to be kind. Believe me, words express kindness.
Yes.
And I deal with people all the time. I see some kind and, oh, Pastor, I am kind. Hallelujah. All right. Get that heart kindness away from me. Amen. But if words express kindness, attitudes express kindness, and action and expense expresses kindness. In the Greek, kindness is expressed as usefulness. How many of us know that sometimes people around us need a kind word?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
Like just letting them know, hey, Jesus loves you, right?
Amen.
You might be going through something, but you know what? Jesus loves you. And at that time, you might be going through something. But remember, you're God's chosen already. You're already chosen. You already know what we have to go through. The Bible clearly talks about just because you're following me now, that doesn't mean that you got your little white picket fence down. You're living where you're living, and that's it. No. He says, no. You got to go through some suffering. But it's going to be all good. Because he says, I got you.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
So in Greek, kindness is expressed as being usefulness. Philemon 11 says, formerly, 11:11, formerly he was useful to you, but now he has become useful both to you and to me. If you want to be useful for God, you have to choose kindness. Because believe me, God don't want people that ain't kind. He can't use you. How can he use you if you ain't kind? If you don't have hearts for others that are going through things in life. Amen? God has been kind to us through the death of his son in our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen? Kindness expressed in Proverbs 11:17 says, those who are kind benefit themselves, but the cruel bring ruins on themselves. Are you cruel tonight? Anybody raise their hand? I'm just making sure. No cruel people in here. Amen? Being kind to others benefit ourselves. The benefit of kindness is the Lord blesses us. How many want to be blessed tonight? Amen? In 2 Timothy 2:24, it says, and the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but must be kind to everyone, able to teach, not resentful, but being kind to everyone if you want to remain blessed. And believe me, you know, as like I said, there's something that we learn. We learn when we clothe ourselves in Christ, amen. We learn how to love towards people, how to show them that compassion. We learn to show them kindness, amen. And letting them know that, hey, there is a God that loves them very much, amen.
Amen.
And then also we talk about humility. Also, humility is a choice. We choose to put that on. Humility begins in our minds. Amen?
Amen.
We have to understand this. Without the Holy Spirit in our lives, humility won't fit. 1 Peter 5, 5-6 says, in the same way, you who are younger, submit yourselves to your elders, all of you. Yeah. Clothe yourself with humility towards one another, because God opposes the proud. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Meaning that if you're a proud person, amen, and there's no humility in your spirit, amen, God opposes that. But then he says, but show favor to the humble.
Yes.
Meaning, when you're humble, and I'm not talking about being humble like just to say, oh, I'm a humble person. And I have a humble pie, amen. No, humbleness, it's not your words. It's your action. People will see it. They're going to see it right through you. Are you really humble for God? So God opposes the proud. Submitting under the authority of the man under God is being humble. Amen?
Amen?
Even me, I have my pastor. And I submit because I know that me myself going out of control, amen, I probably would be out of control. But I needed that guidance. And I humbled myself, amen. Even through people, you know, that I talk to, you know, we have to carry that humility. That's how we'll be able to help others.
Amen.
What is the opposite of humble? We talked about it as prideful. the enemy's clothing line. If you're prideful, you're wearing the enemy's clothing line. Proverbs 15:33 says, wisdom's instruction is to fear the Lord in humility, come before honor.
Amen.
Proverbs 18:12, before a downfall, hello, the heart is haughty, but humility comes before honor. Proverbs 22:4, humility is the fear of the Lord. It wages our riches in honor and life. And our last one is gentleness. Matthew 11:28-30 says, come to me, all of you who are worried and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. I believe that the world takes this from us. It worries us. It brings us burden. It brings heaviness in our life. And I truly believe it, because believe me, I lived the world thinking that this was the right way of this course. But it's not. I found myself doing things on my own strength. I don't know anybody ever felt like that. When you do things on your own strength, you're overwhelmed. You're tired. And the bills still keep piling up, amen? Even though you make a lot of money. I'm telling you. More money, more problems, and more bills, amen? That's the way it goes. The world. But Jesus is saying, take my yoke. It's not hard. The thing that is hard is that we make it hard when we come against it. You see, gentleness is not a weakness, but a strength. It seeks to fulfill the will of God. In other words, it's giving us a direction. When we're gentle to the Holy Spirit. Now we're going to be able to pursue this course that God has us on. Amen. It also shows us for the needs and concerns of others. In other words, you're going to be alert. And you're going to be seeing who needs what they need. Because why? It's the gentleness. Gentleness is a fruit of the Spirit, and we can grow to be gentle and humble like Christ. Amen. You see, people in the world will tell us, if we're gentle, we have no strength. You're a weak person. Matthew 5:5 says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. In other words, the scripture is saying we will be fulfilling in life. And I'm going to do the 3 points of gentleness. Number one, gentleness seeks to fulfill the will of God. Matthew 26:53-54 says, do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put it at my disposal? More than 12 legions of angels. But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way? Meaning Jesus was the Word of God. Jesus was God walking on this earth. He could have said, hey, let the legions and the angels, man, all these people that are coming against me, all these sinners, but he didn't. He wanted to fulfill the will of God, which was the scripture that was already written, that there would be a Messiah walking this earth that was going to die, that God blessed us with this, so we'd be saved. Just try to do the Ten Commandments. Read them. See how far you go. Not, you better get a bloody altar, amen, because that's how they used to sacrifice animals, amen. There goes a cat, the dog, what else do we got to sacrifice? Amen, because that's what they did. They sacrificed animals so they can be forgiven of their first fruits, amen. And they brought it to the altar. Jesus was sacrificed for us. So we have eternal life now with the Father for those who believe. You see, Jesus came to fulfill the will of God. Even when he was dying on the cross, he said, Father, let your will be done. So gentleness seeks to fulfill the will of God for your life. Amen. Now let's look at Isaiah prophesies. Isaiah 53:7. This is in the Old Testament before the resurrection and death was taken place. But Isaiah 53:7 says he was opposed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. And he was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. You see, this was the scripture that Jesus was fulfilling. We have to understand that God has a will for our lives. Yeah. Not to harm us, but to prosper. Jeremiah 29:11. Yes. He has a plan for our lives. But we have to understand that that plan is God's plan. Yeah. And that's the course that we should be on tonight. And what we do through him for his kingdom and not our kingdom. Always tell the church, put God first in your life, man. I don't care what it's going on. I don't care if, you know, your kids don't want to come or whatever. Put God first. Because he says, seek me first before anything. And he's not doing it to be a cruel God, but he's trying to show you, says, hey, you know what? I got you, my son and daughter. If you put me first in your life, I will take care of everything that you have, but you will never need anything. I will add on to you. And believe me that the enemy is always after the husband and wife. That's what his first aim is, to destroy. But I'm going to tell you right now, you put God first, he's going to take care of it. Amen.
Amen.
So we have to understand that God has a will for our lives and not to harm us. Amen?
Amen.
And what we do through him for his kingdom. Our purpose in God is the commission until we go home. So tell your neighbor, get ready and seek the will of God. And then number two, gentleness shows the concern and needs for others. Amen. In other words, gentleness restores because it looks at the needs of others. It motivates by a concern for the well-being of others. In the same reason, Paul instructs Timothy, 2 Timothy 2:25 through 26, said opponents must be gently instructed in the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading them to a knowledge of the truth, and that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil, who has taken them captive to do his will. Meaning the sinners of this world. That's what the enemy. But also Paul instructs Timothy, young Timothy, be gentle. Be gentle. Carry that gentle spirit. So that way you'll be able to reach others. Because how many of us know others come from broken places?
Yes.
And if you're not gentle with it, you might lose them. And that's not what God's plans are. God wants to bring them. Amen? Galatians 6:1 says, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourself, or you also may be tempted. If you're weak in the spirit, then you better get into prayer. But if you're going to fall in that trap, then stay away from it.
Yeah.
Gentleness is more concerned in the welfare of others than self. And let me go to the last point, guys, so we can. And number three, gentleness is a mark of wisdom. And we can all stand tonight. And James 3:17 and 18 reads like this. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace, loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere, peacemakers who sow peace reap a harvest of righteousness. You see, when we carry the fruit of gentleness within our life, things begin to happen.